there'll be a panel discussion actually on climate change and how it is going to be affecting us and how it already is affecting us in Southern California, so I hope you can make it to that. And also, just a little plug, there's some flyers out there for Prehistoric OC on Saturday, October 12th. This is our biggest celebration of all things prehistoric in Orange County, and we have a lot of exhibitors coming this year, a lot of children's activities, and it should be a ton of fun. So
yes, and again, thank you all for coming. We're very excited tonight to have two wonderful speakers and two friends. It's Desiree Martinez. She is a Gabrielino Tongva and an archaeologist with Cogstone Cultural Resource Management Firm. And Craig Torres, who is Gabrielino Tongva and an educator extraordinaire. But they're going to enlighten us today about the importance of shell to the Gabrielino Tongva culture. And they're both very knowledgeable about the Tongva culture, so we're thrilled to have them. So.
Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to our presentation. And before we get started, I just wanted to give you, before we start talking about all that stuff that you see right there, I wanted to give you guys an introduction to, you know, the indigenous people of this area, because a lot of people get confused about the indigenous people of the Los Angeles Basin, and you have all these different names that people hear, but I want to give a little background on the people, but not just the people, the actual environment of this area. And this area was very unique to Southern California, to Los Angeles Basin, because of all the natural resources that it provided. You know, if you want to call them natural resources, we call them relatives. But the first picture that we have up here is a picture of the Los Angeles Basin, and you can see it's surrounded by all these islands that we have on this one image right here. But I want to give you guys an idea of the area that we're talking about. Most of you guys, who hasn't heard the term Los Angeles Basin in this room? So see, I'm talking to California, so you guys know what that is, so that's good. But basically, it's all this area right here. This area right here, that kind of, you know, I guess they call it a basin because it kind of looks like a basin, it's kind of flat. But both Des and I, our ancestors come from these areas right here. And you want to go ahead and do the next slide?
So basically, within Los Angeles Basin, there's a whole bunch of different geographical regions. So one of the things about all Native communities is that we live within the environment. The environment is our family, is what gets us up in the morning, and basically most of the things that we have created is in response to those areas that we are part of. So although when you talk about Native communities within both education and in the public, you get this idea that it's one monolithic group of people. There's a Gabrielino Tongva people, and they only do things one way, and that's not the case. A lot of the cultural traditions that we have created is really based on the environment that we found ourselves. So for instance, we have the interior mountains and adjacent foothills, which include Santa Monica, the San Gabriel, and Santa Ana Mountain areas. So those resources, those people, those plants, those animals that are living there are very different from what we find in the prairies and valleys, which include San Fernando, San Gabriel, San Bernardino. Then you have sheltered coasts, which includes Topanga Canyon, all the way to San Pedro, and then exposed coasts, which are more exposed to the elements, which go from San Pedro to the Bay, and of course you have the Channel Islands, the Southern Channel Islands, which is San Nicolas, San Clemente, Santa Catalina, as well as Santa Barbara. And all of those different places have very different ways, the people that lived in those different places have very different ways of using the resources that were available to them. And within those various regions, there's different vegetations, or biotics of biotic scrub, freshwater marsh, salt marsh. So all of these different resources in these different zones were used extensively by the communities that were within those particular regions.
And you guys can hear me, can you, without the microphone? Yeah. I just wanted to also make a comment about the Los Angeles Basin, because it's very unique to California and has one of the most diverse environmental zones or biozones in the area compared to all California. I mean, you can work out in mind just up there on the screen. That's pretty diverse for a small area like the Los Angeles Basin and the Southern Channel Islands. Very diverse, and that's one of the reasons why everybody comes here. That's one of the reasons why it's so quiet and so popular. The populations were so large in those days, you know, pre-colonization. I mean, you look at it, the way that the Spanish described it was a paradise when they came up here. And it pretty much was compared to a lot of Southern California. So we were very fortunate to live in this area and have everything available to us so that we didn't have to farm. We didn't have to develop agriculture like other cultures did. We had everything that was almost available. Every season there was something available in this area. And again, just like this, describe, you know, those are kind of the areas. You know, I kind of did that little graphic just to show you when we're talking about the coast, the shallow coast, the exposed coast, you know, what, you know, modern day science determines, you know, the labels on those. And you have all of them right there. The islands are very unique. Even amongst themselves, the three islands are very diverse in what they provided. The people from San Diego almost lived exclusively off of shellfish and marine animals. There wasn't a lot of vegetation on that island compared to Catalina Island. So a lot of what I do is cultural education. I do to a lot of third and fourth graders. And one of the things I'm always telling the kids is the land that we lived on determined what we ate, how we dressed, you know, all of that stuff. We didn't dictate it. The land was determined, you know, that for us. And in our areas, I'm always telling them that not all people dress the same. Well, you know, women didn't dress the same, and all the people didn't eat the same foods. It really depended on your area, because those areas that are color diverse are so diverse in what they provide from nature, plants, and animals, that they, you know, our people were very diverse, just even in those things, material culture.
What time frame are we talking about?
What time frame for what?
For when all this took place. I mean, how long ago are we talking? 1,000 years ago? Hundreds?
I'm not sure I understand your question. Are you talking about when the Spanish came up here and permanently colonized? Or?
Prior to that. How far back do the Indians go, basically?
Well, you want to ask about the archaeological perspective?
On the islands, and then a little bit later on the mainland. And so some of the, actually later in the presentation, I have some artifacts that are made out of shell, and we'll be able to see them have been found in an archaeological context. So a lot of stuff that we have here, of course, are more recent things, but the way that the communities have adapted to the environment, of course, has spanned thousands of years, and it's changed here and there because of the changes in the environment in terms of moisture hotness, but it's not hotness. The increase in temperature, but you know the landscape. I don't want to say pretty much stayed the same, but it's you can see the changes.
And it has changed. I mean, we're talking about 100 years, 1,000 years. It changes constantly. Right now, this summer, I was a kid living in Orange County. The weather has changed compared to what it was. We never had a lot of humidity like when I was a kid. I mean, you know, and with the climate changing the way it is right now, we're going through a lot of changes. So it's changing constantly. But, you know, we're specifically talking about probably more or less the time of European called permanent colonization. That's what we're talking about, the way the land know, I mean, I'm not here to talk about how it was 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago. We're specifically talking about when Europeans came up here and established the missions. This is what they saw. This is what we're seeing. And so who are these people that lived here? All right, a lot of people hear the name Tongva and Gabrielino and, you know, one and you know, Hushman, but I know, and I can speak specifically on the Gabrielino Tongva, we didn't have those names before. This is a map, a more contemporary map with a lot of old village names, and that was kind of one of your basic forms of identity. There were many ways that people identified, but going back to your village community, that's how people identify. So, and there you go. So, one of the villages that my ancestors come from is Yap, which is downtown Los Angeles. And the actual name of the community, when you're describing the community or the place of Yap, you would start dropping suffixes on the number of the last letter of consonants on the last part of the word, and then add a suffix on it. So it becomes Yana when you're actually describing the village. It becomes Yabit when you're describing one person from that community. And the Yabitam when it's all the people from that community. And then you have all the other villages too that have basically the same way. So there you go again. The auto-visual community, the NE, NGA, or NG, not a lot of our words, can mean in, of, or place of. So Yana would mean place of Yah, basically. You have the Yavikam, which I said would be people of that particular place, and Yavik, which would be a singular form, person from. So you had all these villages that had all their names and all their identities. And that was one form of amongst a few others. And then you have the way the village communities were connected to each other. When we talk to people, we always have to tell them that there was no such thing as like one tribe and one leadership for a bunch of people. And they were basically, you know, your community that you came from, and all these different communities had all their leaders, and they were connected in different ways. One of those ways was through intermarriage, through a lot of the leadership families that intermarried with other, you know, village communities. And then you had your reciprocation, you know, through redistribution when people would have their feasts and their ceremonies, and they would exchange that way. And shell beads were one of the main ways that they cemented those ties with each other. We're going to talk about that a little bit further on. And then you had the trading that people did with each other when they used the shell beads to, you know, to trade with each other. So, Desiree, do you want to add anything to this?
One of the big things, particularly when we're talking about interrelationships, and a lot of people don't realize the amount of, everybody talks about globalism now, right? That we're so interconnected with all these different people from these different regions, and people think about the ancestors in the past, they think that, oh, they were only in this one little place. This is actually a graphic that was done by Chester King, that he went and looked at all of the marriages that happened during pre-mission times. He looked at mission records and looked at who was married to who prior to the mission, and then tried to make those connections. So the thicker the line, the more people from a particular village married another particular person from that village. So the thicker the line, the more people, for instance, down here, you have a really thick line representing a lot of people who are going from Catalina to Gashpet, which is a village out of the Bono wetlands. And so when you think about interrelationships of Gabrielino community members with other non-Gabrielino people, such as the Kia, as well as the Chumash, as well as the Hachiman, we have, there's these connections that have always existed. And a lot of that has to, in some instances, happens because of where those villages are. So one of the reasons why you would have these connections with these different villages is one who might have a family member that had married into that village, but also it's a way of protecting yourself should your village at some time need some type of resource. So if you happen to be out by San Pedro and unfortunately the fishing isn't good, you can then reach out to another village that you have connections with through marriage and say, hey, we need some help. Do you think that you can help us by giving us some food to help us through this tough time? And so, you know, again, we think about that the prehistoric communities were just in and among themselves in these little bounded areas, and in fact, there was all of these connections going on. We really do see it in particular when we're looking at trade relationships. And this is something that has been documented through time. This map is based on some early work that was done in the 40s and looking at various sites, some of them at Harvard Peabody Museum, and looking to see where you would see, for instance, Shell, because this is what it's based on, moving from the west coast all the way through the southwest. So Gabrielino Tongva territory was the center of trade on the west coast. We have documentation of shell beads, square root shell beads, for instance, going all the way up to Oregon. We have other pieces of material, such as soapstone, for instance, going down south. So we have not only interconnections with the villages that were in Southern California, but we have huge connections with these other populations. And you see through time all of this accumulation of these objects that are from other places. There's actually Haavakam pottery, as well as pottery from Mesa Verde, that's found in Gabrielino context and archaeology. So when I like to talk about the ancestors, they were, you know, just as connected as we are. Of course, they didn't have Facebook, but I'm sure they knew the gossip that, you know, so and so was doing over there in Snake Town. That, you know, and also these trade networks were also the communication networks as well. Like I said, gossip traveled with the person that was walking the trail and sharing all of the objects that they were bringing and trading and exchanging. One of the things that I found in my own research and trying to document information and relationships of Catalina to the mainland and other communities is that other communities such as the Cahuilla, who live in the Palm Springs area, in the Moreno Valley area, they actually have stories about themselves going to Catalina and traversing through Tongva territory. Jane Hinn, who's Cahuilla, and was talking to some ethnographers, talked about how her brothers and her dad would go down to Paula, down in San Diego County, and then they would actually build a raft and float over to Catalina to get shell. And then they would take that shell back. Unfortunately, she didn't talk about what they did with that shell, but it was something that they did, and it was something that was important enough for them to actually build a raft to go and do that. And that was at the turn of the century. So there's that shell was important. Shell to Catalina, because I'm sure they could have gotten a scallop shell, which she called it a serrated shell. I assume she means scallop. You can get scallop shells other places, but they went particularly to Catalina. So there's something more than just seeing the shells as something to be exchanged. There obviously must be some type of power with it. When you look at Francisco Potencio, who was a net or a leader of the Palm Springs Cahuilla, he talks about in his Stories and Legends of the Palm Springs Indians that in his bundle, he has a sacred bundle, he's the ceremonial leader of the community, he has a string of beads from Catalina, shell beads. And he talks about, he knows the genealogy that he got them from a community, at San Gabriel, and they got them from Catalina. And so the fact that he has these string of beads that he actually keeps in his sacred bundle that he uses during ceremony tells you the beads have more significance than just beads. So when I talk about, they say when you read that shells were only used as money, as a form of exchange, that's putting it in our capitalist sense, our capitalist ideas, that actually means more, the beads meant more. Yes, you would exchange a string of beads for a particular item, but you would also give those string of beads as an honoring or acknowledgement. So for instance, a string of beads would be sent from a community to another community if they had a death in the family and they were having a mourning ceremony. So if you couldn't go, you would send a condolence as a string of beads to that community, and that community would then keep it. And sometimes when that person would then visit that village, that deed from the community would be given back to the original giver. And so, you know, again, you gotta think outside the box when we're thinking about the connections that people have with each other. It's not just, particularly a lot of archaeology likes to put things in economic terms and likes to put things in give and take and black and white. So there's more to the story, and that's one of the things that we need to share with you today.
So, you have all these different ways that people were connected to prior to European colonization, and you know, through these vast trade networks all across Southern California, going all the way to the deserts and, you know, further out into the Great Basin. And all that changed when the missions began to establish themselves along the coast of California in the late 1700s, when they started to establish themselves permanently. And in our area, the mission that was established in the previous area was the San Gabriel mission in 1771. And a lot of the indigenous people in the area were reduced into those missions, and they weren't necessarily all from the Los Angeles Basin. So you had a lot, most of them were, but then you had people that were coming in and being brought in from, you know, other areas, people that spoke different languages, that were all being brought into one particular mission that had a particular name. So in our areas, San Gabriel, Gabrielino. You know, that's where we get the Gabrielino. And I remember my mom telling me when we were really young, she would use the name Gabrielino. And I always thought she was pronouncing the name Gabrielino wrong. And it wasn't until I got older that I realized that that's the Indian way, the Indian Spanish-like way of pronouncing it. She would say, I'd always ask her to get where we were from, and she would always say, well, Gabrielino from the San Gabriel mission. So my identity formed very early on with connections to this land on, you know, her side of the family. But about in the 1850s, after the missions had already been secularized, and about the time when the United States took over, then this term for us started to come into use, the Gabrielino. And that referred to anybody that was brought into the San Gabriel mission. Didn't necessarily mean that you were Tongva, but it just meant that you were from the San Gabriel mission. So that's where the name Gabrielino comes from.
If you actually look in all the mission records, the baptismal records, death records, etc., those missionaries made those really good documents, and they actually have recorded where the person who was either getting baptized or died comes from, as well as where their parents were. So when we look at the mission records, we can tell which people were what from what particular village, and a lot of times as well if they were from a different community.
And it's true for a lot of people, and there are a lot of modern day Gabrielino people, Tongva people that unfortunately can't do it. In my family, I'm fortunate enough to know the villages that I come from, and they are in the Los Angeles Basin. So there's no disputing that I am from this land, because that's where the villages are from, they're from in our traditional territory. Another name that you guys might hear associated with this is Tongva, or Tongva. You don't really pronounce the G in our language, but this word was, or this description, this destination, came about from this woman right here, who was, you know, Gabrielino Serrano from the San Gabriel mission. And she said the people from the San Gabriel were called Tongva. But that doesn't mean all the people in the Los Angeles Basin and the islands were called Tongva. She referred to it as the people from the San Gabriel Valley. But in the 1970s, we kind of took that word back, and instead of using Gabrielino, which was a mission name, we wanted to empower ourselves, you know, decolonization, and choosing, putting meaning into the word. And it's the word that we began using, which comes from a word in our language, which is a word for the earth, Mother Earth. So it comes from that word. And you can see how I have it labeled up here, and, you know, where you get, you know, the meaning to all the different parts of it. It's not a name that everybody chooses, but for me, I know in my community, it's a form of decolonization. It's a word that we've chosen ourselves to empower ourselves rather than have somebody else label us. So we use that word today, along with sometimes, you know, I'll even use the names from my village communities also, because because that's a more personal identity that I have there too, the connection to those ancestral village communities. Do you want to talk about this? You talk about pro work.
It's interesting that we have this this quote up here. So Alfred Kroger was is known as the father of California Native American ethnography. He did a lot of work. He sent out a lot of his students. He was from Berkeley, and they collected a lot of information. They practiced what was called salvage anthropology. So they went to all the old Indians out there that they got that were still could remember things that were done prior to contact and recorded all of that information. Unfortunately, the way that he went about it, he ignored a lot of people as well. And if you know anything about people in your community, you know, there's always those people that shy away, and there's always those people like, I know, and then give information. So he did record a lot of good information, but there's also a lot of information that's suspect. But of course, this one we like, because this is the gathering of what thought to be one of the wealthiest and most powerful groups south of the Tehachapi. Certainly were the wealthiest and the most thoughtful of all the Shoshoneans of the state, and dominated the civilization whenever contacts occur. So of course that's true, right? One of the things, particularly when we do work in California and students, you always see a lot of the curricula talk about the Chumash and how wonderful they are and how they're the most advanced civilization in California and aren't they great. And you never hear about our community, which was just as, if not more, wonderful than the Chumash. But that's one of the things that has been lost, and that's one of the reasons why we go out and talk about our community, is because a lot of that information, because at the time when they were doing the recording, a lot of our communities were basically workers on ranches that were being run by Mexican Americans and American people. And so when a lot of the recording was happening, and a lot of government agents would be coming out and saying, hey, we want to deal with this Indian problem, a lot of the ranchers would say, we don't have a problem, we have good Indians, they're doing our work, they're not a problem at all. And so unfortunately, although we were still living, we were living in a new time period, we were still practicing our traditions. In some instances, because of prices on our heads, where there would actually be money being given for Indian scalps and heads, a lot of us, particularly my family, did a lot of things where we pretended to be Spanish on the outside, but in fact we were still practicing our traditions at night, because you didn't want to go around and say, hey, I'm Indian, come take my scalp. And so it's interesting to see that Kroger in 1925, and looking at what he did collect, that he saw that that a lot of the material culture that we did, that he was seeing, as well as the information that he was collecting, could recognize that we were just as important of a community in Southern California as a lot of the other communities that might have been recognized previous to that.
And I mean, this picture in here, I kind of stole from the Chumash again, because we don't really have a lot of images of how our ancestors dressed, even though I am how they dressed. I haven't recreated a lot of stuff. But our throughout the coast, especially in Southern California, Chumash, all the way down to we all dress very similar because the environment is similar. And there were differences, according to your community, your status, you're gonna have your differences. But basically, it was the plant fiber skirts, and for the people who came from families of leadership, they usually wore the mountain skins and heavily decorated with a lot of shell. And that kind of gives us a very, quick overview from the basic, where a lot of plant fibers would have been used, and men usually didn't make it. But it was the women who dressed up, and then you see some of the background and black cloth on a bit. But because of that, because of the environment that we lived in and the resources, we have a lot. We have an abundance of things here. And I know that some of the groups that lived out in the mountain areas east of us, Serrano, they had a name that they used to describe the Gabrielino. And again, this is why what I'm talking, what I was describing earlier, when I say Gabrielino, the Gabrielino could be anybody brought into the mission. I think they're
kind of loosely referring to a lot of coastal people, but they refer to us as Haavakam. And Haavakam in different dialects and different things, it meant either the beautiful people or the people that were clothed, because we wore so many things. And after hearing that comment by Kroger for such a long time, when I was a lot younger and doing research early on, I heard this, and he was talking about us being the wealthiest and the most generous. I'm like, I don't understand what that means. And then as I started learning more about this and talking to others and how this term came up, one of the stories that I was told was that it was based on the shell being exchanged. And when you exchange those shell beads with somebody, it was like a commitment. When you gave that string of shell beads to somebody, it was more than just shell beads. But these are some, and there are different types of shell beads too. But when you gave that shell bead to another community, it was a commitment. It was a commitment to participate in their ceremony. For us, for funerals, we weren't allowed to do certain parts of our ceremonies. We had a covenant with the clan to do those. So there was like an obligation when you exchange that with somebody, they were obligated to come and participate in your ceremony for funerals and for other things. So this was, as Des had said, it meant more than just shell beads. It was like a contract. You cemented that tie with that person, and they were obligated to participate. Have any of you ever had an invitation to somebody's party, a very close family member, and you ignored it? What happens to you when you ignore them and you don't RSVP? It was kind of the same thing. You know, if you offered shell beads to somebody and they didn't accept, then they were suspect. You wondered why they didn't accept. You know, why were they turning that down? Were they trying to do something to you, or you know, you were always suspect of that. But the reason that name came about is because the people from the coast were so generous, and they had acquired so many shell beads, and they would wrap them around their necks, and the men would wrap it around their heads, that they were adorned so much that this word came about, Haavakam, the beautiful people, because of what the bounty was from the Los Angeles Basin. When you think of the coast, it provides so much compared to other parts of Southern California. So we were able to be generous, and that's where that came comes from, Haavakam.
Was that the basis of the wealth that you talked about, or wealth?
Or shall be exchanged, yeah. And because of the environment that you live in. You know, you think of the coast, even today, what's the prime real estate? It's on the coast. And it was the same way back then. The islands provided some things, but not as much as the coast. The inland provided some things, but not as much as the coast. So those coastal people that were connected to the ocean, that way, they had something that was very valuable that other people sought out too. Now we're gonna start talking about shells, okay? But I'm sure you guys are talking about shells. But with us, there was such an abundance of shells and shellfish on the coast, and we utilized a lot of these different types of shells for different types of things. The ones that I can think of just off the top of my head would be alimony, mussel shells, and olive shells. Olive shells are a very important source of money. This is the abalone. And two of the main types of abalone that we used were these two right here. And whether they came from your exact area or you traded them, this is the red abalone and this is the green abalone. So these two were utilized as food source because of the actual food it provided. But fish hooks were made out of these. This is a pretty big fish hook. Fish hooks were usually this small. But this is a fish hook that's used to represent something else in my community. That, why do you guys think that this abalone or mussel shell was so popular as a fish hook? If you just look at it. Yeah, because when this is in the sun and it's shining, and it sparkles, those fish see that, and that's one of the first things they go for. So the people usually didn't have to use bait, the guys didn't have to use bait for fishing and stuff like this. very popular with the mussel shallot outlining the fish hooks. We also made beads out of that, and we made a lot of the shallot ornament. I'm going to pass this around so you guys can take a look at some of this stuff too. And there's stuff. You guys know what this might have been used for? There's different reasons that I've been told that I like the one that I'm next like to you. You know, how many of you guys have been in a sauna or a sweathouse? And, well, and I would say a sauna because if you guys go into a sauna, the first thing you do is wipe yourself, right? Well, in those days, we didn't have towels, so this was an implement that was used to scrape off the sweat. And some people have told me that it was used if you have a rabbit skin blanket or any type of cape that would be used to close that too. So it could have been used for different things, but this comes from the Rim of Babylon.
And if you see here from the archaeological context, it's actually that same piece of the abalone and it had little holes up on top. So it was probably used for decoration. We also see them used as hairpins. So, put your hair in a bun and stick it in. You know, it's supposed to be.
And, you know, speaking of Haavakam, you know, this is what they were probably known for because this would have been a woman's master. And usually if you came from a family of leaders, you're going to have your skirt decorated and heavily adorned to separate yourself from everybody else. It was a way of identifying people. So this one was decorated with abalone. You can see the abalone. And usually on the side, they have another one up here that was decorated with shells. But I mean, this is where that name comes from too, Haavakam. Because when the women would dress up, they would adorn their skirts at the bottom of that. Those shells in the ocean. So very, very popular shell, because today we still use a lot of them.
Yeah, another type of abalone is the black abalone, which I have a picture of over there, and I have one here if you guys want to see the abalone, depending on what depth you find them, that's where the different types reside. And so these are the fish hooks that are the small ones. And we actually have somebody here that wrote a thesis on fish hooks. And then these little ornaments down here. And again, these are all from archaeological collections, both from the Natural History Museum at the Smithsonian, as well as at Harvard.
And do just one more quick thing on the abalone. Just on the abalone, a lot of times, you know, the way I described for you guys earlier, I talked about how our people were connected to each other and there was no such thing as one tribe. I always use this as an analogy. And I tell them, if you look at all the different colors in abalone and how they're kind of all blending into each other, and you can't tell where one ends and one begins. It's the same way here in Southern California. All the different communities were like this in here. They were all overlapping and connected with each other in that way. So I use the rainbow of the abalone as an analogy to how our people were, because it's very complex here in Southern California. It's not very simple to describe. I mean, nowadays, you know, we use the name Gabrielino, and people usually encompass everybody. Even though we still have a lot of Gabrielino communities, it's still kind of the same way. They call them factions today, but we promise it's traditional for us. And that's been polished, by the way, so they don't come out of the ocean like that.
So another type of shell that we use was what we talk turban shell. And one we use, and I kind of find the, we have so many things on here.
The
turban
shell?
Yeah. Anyway, they come in all sizes, and not only are they delicious meals, they come really huge, but we also use the center spiral, and they got ground down to the top, is what the spiral looks like once you get rid of all the rest of the shell, and then they move ground down into two beads, and you can still see what the little turns are. And these two were actually collected from South Carolina Island in 1876 by Paul Schumacher, who was one of the first explorers that went around and collected a lot of things from California, not only Island, but also on the mainland. So this is a little small one, but you can find them in the wild when you don't harvest them in an archaeological context. They're much larger.
The olive shell. look at all the different types of shell that were taken from this one shell. I mean, there were so many types of shell beads that were taken from this one little shell. We have some around. And those are those, the jar right there are olive, smaller olive shells that have been collected from Catalina Island. But I also have some in this jar that are a lot larger, and you don't find them like this anymore. But this gives you a better idea of how some of the shells are taken from that. Some of the tiniest shells were as tiny as this that I'm going to pass around. And you can, it amazes me how they would have gotten the shells this tiny. I can see how they could have done the larger ones. We're still not sure how they do these small ones. But these things are tiny. And we're going to be, I don't know if Dev wants to elaborate on some of the different types of shells that we're taking from this. Usually with us, the tinier and the finer the shell, the more value it has in your ceremonial exchange. So those really tiny shells are very important as opposed to the larger shells.
So actually I have a nice kit that was put together, and there's a typology that a lot of archaeologists use, and olive level shell beads are used to date a lot of archaeological sites. So depending on how old the site is, there are various different types of beads. There's lip beads, cupped beads, all these different types, and this kit actually has olive level shell beads and their casts, both in California and the Great Basin. So there are not those beads. So these are not real, but they're cast of real objects that were found in archaeology. And so you have little itty bitty shell beads, and then you have these bigger disc beads and cup. I mean, there's so many different types, and these are all labeled in a particular letter, and it's coded so that you can see what I'm looking in the handbook to see what kind it is, and you can actually date your site based on those different types of beads. And there's so many different varieties, and this is just the olivella shell. So you can get actually little tubes made from the olivella shell. You can use the whole shell itself as a bead just by what's called blocking off the top or grinding down the top and then straightening. You can cut them in half. I mean, there's just so many different variations. It's interesting, and again, they have been
one of the things too that I learned in my research is that not all of these different types of shells were used at all at the time of European colonization. There are different types of shells that were used at different time periods. We're giving you an overview of all the different types of shells that were used at different time periods. We're not focusing on a specific time period because some of these shells at the time of European contact or the shell beads were not as popular as like, for instance, the big clamshell disc, by the time Europeans had come and colonized, they were kind of outdated, and you had more of olive shells and even some of the abalone shell beads. So it covers different time periods also. There's some are more popular at different times than others.
Yeah, particularly when the missionaries started coming in the 1700s, there had already been contact between our communities and Europeans, so you get a lot of trade beads. Particularly with first contact with Europeans in the 1500s, 1600s, you get these beads all the way from Venetia. I mean, all these different types. So I don't want to say they replaced the shell beads, but they complemented and in some instances continued to have the same type of significance, if not more, because they weren't everywhere, but they did. They were used by high society people who had high status and could quote unquote afford them. So this is what Craig was talking about in terms of the clam. And so the pismo clam is one of those that was regularly used.
But this is only one type, and you can see some of the different types of
shall be taken from the clam shell.
So you can make them in tubes, you can make them in discs, you can score them,
back to helping them to return back to the island with nothing to help them to come back to the island.
And then, as I have mentioned too, mussel shells were used also. And this is our California mussel shell that we have here in California. When I was in Sonora last year, I found these on the beach. These are the ones that we have in Sonora. So a lot bigger than ours. But the shell beads were actually taken from here. Because it's, and some of the mussel shell, there's an iridescence also. But I do have some of the mussel shells right here. You can take a look at those as they're going around. Because they were also a form of the shell bead exchange also. And then, let's see, what else do I have? And there's some other shells you can take a look at and ask us any questions. We have the shark vertebrae. Now, I know that I was told, and so your families came from families of fishermen or whatever, you weren't supposed to take the shark. There was a taboo against it. I don't know how it was with people inland or people that didn't have a connection with it, because it was believed that you hunted the shark and the shark would eat you when you both went to the water, so you didn't really hunt the shark. If your family did that for a living, they were out there. That's what I would, these are shark vertebrae that would have been made into beads also. And then we have, we're going to talk about those. We have these things right here. And Des can talk a little bit about these as she has referenced on the slide. But I didn't know anything about these types of shells. And there's a particular shell shop that I go to, and I picked up a lot of shells, and I was gravitating towards these. I didn't know our people used these shells, but making rattles and things like that for music, I gravitated towards and started making shell rattles out of them. And later I found out that we actually used them, and there's difference of opinion as how they were used, and Des can talk about that. But today I make a lot of shell rattles out of them, and this particular. Shell, the giant Pacific ape cockle. And I have to familiarize myself with that name, but that's one that's native to this area. And then you have these two, the scallop shells, that were used as rattles. And then today I use them in jewelry making, like when I do projects with the kids, I have them use the flat end scallop to like this. And I have, you know, made things out of both of these, but that's the scallop shell.
What kind of shell is this?
Those are shark vertebrae.
Shark vertebrae?
Yeah.
No, just the picture up here on your right hand side is actually something from Catalina, and their term treasure boxes. And we have items in there. There are other ways that you shell that have to do with the sacred, have to do with the spiritual, that was the connection with that power that was greater than us. So we have connection with the animals, the plants, and the people, but we also have contact with a higher power. And so it's exactly the kind of same size as the large one, rattler going on, and it has things in them as well. We have never opened them because they're shut with a car, but they have items that are inside and they can be found up in various places. So we have a lot of things that you guys can come up and look at. I have a lot of other shells that we haven't talked about that are here in the Pacific Ocean, in Gabrielino territory. I have some other different types of abalone that you can. We definitely have the generosity of the Cooper Center. They brought in some of their collections, and you can see some of the archaeological things up close and personal and see how small my ancestors were able to make, how talented they were. And then, you know, just come up and have anything.
No, the only thing that I have to say is we also use a lot of shells in contemporary ways. You know, I made some rounds of sea urchins. Very, very delicate, and I found out that it's very easy. So I go ahead and
protected marine sanctuaries out there. But I kind of want to do it, go to a shell shop and just, you know, leave what little we have left, what very, very little we have left in nature, even there, like we belong. Because it just in my travels to Baja and Sonora, I see how so much they have that we've lost already. And because from, you know, there's different things that we do here that they you know, still retain over there in those parts of Mexico. And I encourage people to use these things in nature to, you know, these experiments. Like, these things I have collected over the years. Like, you know, you always have to be conscious of where you're buying things from or where they get them from, because they're different in some other place has that, you know, marine life or those shells and stuff. And I guess we can kind of leave it open to questions too before they start coming up to the table. So if any of you guys have any questions, you know, feel free to ask and we'll answer.
Yep.
Do you,
we have a lot of creation stories and oral narratives, and there's different stories that come from different areas, but we do have a lot of stories. And one of the stories that many of the stories that we have are connected to one of our sites in Long Beach, Paloma, where the University of Cal State Long Beach sits. So we have a lot of stories that are originally there and are related to that place over there. It's one of our, all to us, all events are sacred. But there are certain places where certain events took place. And, you know, when somebody asked us earlier how long we've been here, I think we're talking about, well, we feel that we've always been here. There's been migrations throughout, I'm sure, throughout hundreds of years. There's been migrations from other places. But the people that are down here, you know, people that the Spanish now would make permanent colonies. So we feel we've always been here.
Gavin, the first floor of the facility, they have a small structure. They have a snail shell. The whole of it. I think it's said in the presentation that it's like a piece of
stuff. I haven't seen it downstairs.
I'm not familiar with any of those ones like that. I know we have our long way to go to the house shop. It could have been.
Yeah, my experience with that one is where this is tough. What did you see? Do you know anything about how that was processed? Like, if people were taking out the market?
Yeah, it was pounded with rocks. So we would have it in a stone bowl, and then we would have a stone pestle.
Using that sand with a stone, you know, an abrasive. There are
different ways that that they were shaped and broken up. Sandstone, and you know the sandstone, and you know the rough surface that you have, it's like sandpaper. And there were other stones that were, I'm sure you utilized as well, like that.
Did they sell the world like limestone now? So it was more?
Do not.
The limestone?
No.
It's still not sure.
No, there's a whole bunch of different theories.
For us, I know in my tribe, we don't have a lot of recording
is that we have songs, but we don't have like spoken word. So we have some people who are working on it, but and it's in the process of kind of being brought back. You know, but we have no public speakers. Like, you know, a lot of us have different aspects of it, different parts of the language, and you know, like Michelle will do up here, some of the words and things like that. But it's not a speaking language, it's not something that people speak.
We have some community members that are working with the linguist from UCLA, Camero, and she's using her knowledge as a linguist and looking at related languages such as Serrano and Zia, and trying to recreate based on what's been recorded, because you had so many people recording the language in many different ways, and trying to come up with what the words would sound like. So if you're on Facebook, there's actually Tongva Word of the Day. So if you want to learn Tongva, you can friend that or like the page. And they've actually, and she actually has some of the community members actually talk, speaking the word, but we'll never know if that's how it was spoken. She's using her best guess to recreate the language. But we have nobody that can speak it. We do have people that know some prayers, but depending on who you talk to and who they learned it from, sometimes you have different pronunciations, the same thing in the song, you have a little bit different rhythms. But it's one of those things where, you know, we have what we have, and we're trying to deal with what has been recorded and what we're trying to do.
And it's looking at the languages too, like the people that are called Serrano Indians. There's a very, very closely related to ours, and they're at a different level than we are. They have some speakers, and they're in the process of revival of their languages and teaching to the younger community members. But if we wanted to learn how certain things sound, it would probably be best to go to them, because they're, you know, the way they pronounce some of their words and their language are probably very similar to ours. Yeah.
I just want to say thank you so much. This is really enlightening. I don't know about everybody else, but I really learned a lot, and I'm really happy that Desiree and Craig are here with us, and within Orange County, we have the Greater Los Angeles area. It's trying to keep the government and the culture alive and share it with all of us. So I really appreciate you coming.
Feel free to remember.